two speakers, so we're gonna have Dominic Woodward who's gonna be speaking on commercial conversions, which will be interesting. And we're gonna have Neil McCoy Ward, who's actually one of my mentors. He's got one of the biggest rent to rent portfolios in the UK. He's a very renowned speaker throughout the UK, so I guess it's something that you would have wanted to miss. I would have wanted to miss it. I'm happy he's coming over to speak. And yeah, it should be a really good one to launch a new venue. Okay, so who's ready for the main speaker of the evening?
Yeah,
sure. Louise is. Louise runs a company called Very Smart Consulting. She's helped businesses such as Ansible and Global Xerox Services to help with the systems and processes. So it's safe to say that she knows what she's doing. So if you're going to give a huge round of applause, and please give your support to Louise Broom.
Do you have missions? And put your hands up if you want 2017 to be different and to be the best yet. Brilliant. Well, hopefully you're going to get something from tonight. So I'm going to talk to you about how to automate repetitive tasks in your business, how to convert more leads into sales and make more money, and how to grow and scale quickly and effortlessly. So first of all, I'd just like to say thanks to Mo for inviting me here tonight to come speak. And thanks to you guys for coming on Valentine's evening to come and listen to me speak. I feel very honoured. Right, so let me figure this quicker out. There we go. So first of all, who am I? Who are we? This is our Valentine's evening. This is me and Steve. This is my father. This is how we spend Valentine's.
It would cheaper than a bunch of flowers.
Business was born out of necessity, really. Whilst we were running our other business, Very Smart Heating, with a newborn baby and a toddler. So, as you can imagine, it was all a bit crazy. And sorry, bear with me. So, Stu has worked with lots of different businesses, like Mo said, with Xerox Global Services and Ansible. It wasn't me, I'm afraid, that worked for Ansible. I hope everybody here in the false pretenders. But his experience is operational efficiency, customer experience. But he's never had his own business, so he's never had that experience. He's always had the luxury of having a big team and a PA to delegate to. Whereas I did have experience being my own boss. I ran my own successful physiotherapy practice. It was quite a pioneering physio practice. I actually specialised in, you can see there, horse riders, doing rehabilitation and performance analysis for horse riders. So I was quite used to being my own boss, and I'm sure many of you out there that are a one-man band, you know what it's like to be the chief exec, chief finance officer, the chief marketing officer, the chief cook and bottle washer, and you're used to wearing lots of different hats and being lots of different roles. And I was used to very much being in control and wasn't particularly good at delegating. The problem with me and my business was that it was all about me. So my business was built solely around myself, so it was very difficult for me to scale and grow my business and exit myself from the business. So we started Very Smart Heating. And as a result of applying our very different knowledge, experience and backgrounds to Very Smart Heating in order to systemize, automate and grow that business, Very Smart Consulting emerged. And we're now able to help people just like yourselves get back in control of your business. In fact, our mission is to turn the biggest problem in your business at the moment into your biggest asset. So, if you can go on holiday to Bali for a month and your business continues to work without you, then this talk probably isn't for you. But if you can't even go to the loo in peace without answering the phone or checking your emails, then hopefully you're going to get something from tonight. Not that long ago, offices were filled with filing cabinets and employees filing information, making phone calls to make appointments, chasing paperwork, doing all these routine manual tasks. But successful businesses, small businesses, don't have their employees doing these manual tasks anymore. They use software such as Infusionsoft to automate repetitive things like this so that the people in what they do best. So how many times have we been told that we need to work on our business, not in our business?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, everybody read the E-Myth, Life Leverage.
Yeah.
Yeah. So we all know what we should be doing, but perhaps we don't know how to do it, or we haven't yet found the time to do it. So tonight I'm going to tell you about how you can improve your consistency and your efficiency within your business processes and get consistency, consistent results with far less effort, simply by following our five-step plan. So why should we systemize? Anybody feel like this? So firstly, a systemized business doesn't depend on you or a key member of your team. So if an emergency occurs, or if you want to go on holiday, basically anybody that can pick up your process manuals, watch video instructions, can actually get the task done. So we're going to do a little experiment. Now I know Chris has done this before, but if you've not done it for a while, it'll be good to see if you've actually improved. So can we all stand up? Right. So I'd like you to sit down if, when the phone rings, your office telephone number, if you personally have to ring to answer it. Okay, got rid of you again. Now sit down if you have to fulfil the order. So by that I mean, do you have to dispatch a parcel? Do you have to check tenants in? Do you have to actually do you have to fulfil that particular order? Alright. Sorting them in from the boys. Right, do you have to go into the office every day? Sit down if you do. Right. Can sit down if you can't go on holiday for a week without the wheels falling off.
Well, right now.
If you can go on holiday for a week, stay standing without the wheels falling off.
Good.
Yeah. Fortnight. Month.
Yeah, a month.
No, I think I'm good for a month.
6 months on a desert island, no phone, no internet access.
There's internet access.
Yeah, so that was pretty good there at the end. So basically, if you're left standing until fairly near the end, congratulations, that means that your business has got the X factor. So essentially, it exists independently of you, and this means that you've created a saleable asset. There's more value to it because you've got your systems and your processes in place, and it doesn't just depend on you. But systemization is much, much more than just documenting processes. So I'm sure we're all fairly comfortable with that, particularly if we've been reading our books and doing our homework. So just because we write something down doesn't mean to say that it's particularly going to work very well. It is always better to get something down on paper than nothing and actually make a start. And one of my favourite sayings is version one is better than version not. But the real art is looking at the process critically and constructively and saying, how can we make this better? And sometimes, Stu calls it going native. So if you're so stuck in the business, it's really difficult to look objectively at what you do. And sometimes a fresh pair of eyes from the outside can actually challenge you and say, why are you doing it like this? Can we make it a little bit better? So why automate? According to research, entrepreneurs spend 68% of their time on manual tasks instead of focusing on strategy and goals. And one example of such a time drain is actually responding to emails. Now it's interesting that Nigel was talking about logging, how much time you spend doing what. I actually did a little experiment with a time tracker just because I'm a bit of a geek. And the majority of my time in a day was spent responding to emails, and I was like, right, no, I'm sorting my inbox out and outsourcing it to my PA. So it is possible. But and a third of entrepreneurs that were interviewed in this research actually agreed with me that email is actually the biggest time strain on their business. But would it surprise you to know that not all incoming email requires an original response from us? We can actually automate the responses. So a contact us form on the website shouldn't be left going to an inbox where it might be forgotten about or ignored for a few days. Because if the customer has to wait for more than 30 minutes to get a response, it decreases the chance of converting a lead by 21 times. So with automation, a response can be sent literally as soon as the person's filled in that form. Or you might want to just build in a small time delay to make it look as though an actual human sent it. And you can also categorise it, so if they want a price request, a brochure request, something like that, you can actually make sure that the correct response gets sent to them. So not only will this time saving mean that you've got more time to go out and do whatever it is that you're good at to make more money, it also means that if your customer gets a swift response, they're far more likely to make a purchase, so you've got a double bonus. So email is just one area that we can document, that we can automate within our business. And most business activities, such as the key areas of finance, marketing, sales, customer service and HR, we can document things. So can we think of any examples, not to automate things, can we think of any examples of where we're already using automation in our business? Because it's a small group, we're going to have loads of audience participation.
Direct debits.
Customers paying by direct debit
and business paying
their suppliers
by direct debit.
Yeah, good. Any other examples that anybody's using?
Autoresponders.
Yeah.
We've got a rostering system, a rota, things, internet based.
So things that you might not even consider, like Hootsuite and Buffer, that's all, social media scheduling, that's basic automation. If you're using things like Xero, you might have if there's any outstanding invoices, so it automatically triggers chasing emails saying, please will you pay me, your invoice is outstanding. So there's lots of opportunities to build in automation within your business processes. So, I'm going to tell you about our five-step system. Now, unfortunately, there's no clever acronyms for this. We're going to have a quick whistle stop tour through all of them, and then we're just going to concentrate on the first two steps. So, plan. We're going to identify the biggest opportunities and threats in our business at the moment, and then we're going to choose the biggest one to work on first. Build. Once we've identified the key challenge, we're going to document and improve the process, and this is actually where we can build in the automation to save time and money. In the launch phase, we're going to implement the new improved process. And in the review bit, this is where we actually need to generate some numbers to measure the effect of the intervention to see if it's improved things, basically. So ideally, we're going to create a user-friendly reporting dashboard so we can see what we've done. And then finally, grow. We're going to create a six-month plan for growth, detailing sales, marketing, and process automation. Right. I need a guinea pig. So we're going to go back to the beginning and take a closer look at the plan. So ideally, we need time to take a step away from our business to get a bird's eye view of actually how it operates. Yeah, right, you're thinking, by the time I've finished answering my emails, my phone calls, my invoices, and I just collapse in a heap on the sofa with a can of lager, and that's me done. Anybody feel like that? Anybody want to be a guinea pig and come to the front? I'm going to pick somebody. We don't have any guinea pigs. Come on. Who wants to come to the front and do this exercise? Oh, can I have some digits to chat with as well? Is anybody good at writing?
I'm good at writing. I used to be a teacher.
We're writing now. Right. Okay. Kelly. Sorry. Right. So, things that you do in a day. So, I'll just share with everybody what you do.
It's Valentine's Care.
So property business side things is I book viewings. Get contractors. Okay. Oversee refurb work.
Overseas?
Oversee. Research and figures and due diligence sites.
Yes.
Source materials sometimes.
Right,
yeah. Do a lot of going over to the HMO and checking that.
Right.
So that travel.
So yeah, checking property really.
Travel and checking.
Search for finance, JD Finance.
How do
social interaction. Anything else? Okay, so what do you do that makes money? This is what we're all interested in.
The end product makes money.
So what did you do to make that end product happen?
All these.
Right. So what specifically?
The getting offices up and running.
So what is the key bit that is it finding them?
I suppose finishing the leaf first.
Viewings and converting those viewings into tenancies that makes the money. That's where, you know, it has to be gorgeous for the tenant, it's not making money.
Right.
Right.
Okay.
I don't know.
Right.
Okay, we'll put a question out there, yeah. Anything else?
I said should you diligence because if you buy the right books at the right price, make money when you buy.
Okay. Yeah. Right. So we're going to think now, we're going to challenge you here. Do you have to do all of that? Now at first thought you're probably going to say, yeah, of course I do. Who else is going to do it? But what could you get somebody else to do?
The materials. I was just literally saying to my mum yesterday, I'm steaming, I shouldn't be doing this, I don't have time to do this.
Right, let's put a line through that.
Oh, I can do that.
Yeah. Now, booking viewings, mm-hmm. Booking them, not conducting them, booking them, do you have to do that?
Yeah.
Do you have to do that?
At the minute, yeah.
Do you have to do
that?
No.
So it's possibly.
Okay. Well, remind me, who's the people that we're contacting down here?
The contractors, John.
Do you have to do that? Do you have to do that?
I need to think of another way around it.
You do.
Yeah.
But do you have to do it?
At the minute. I found a better solution.
Okay. Right, can we cross it
no,
off?
No, cross it off.
Cross
it off.
Cross it off. It's gone.
Right.
No coming back.
Do you have to oversee the refurb?
Yeah, because
every day.
Not necessarily every day, no.
Okay, so can we put a little line through that?
Mm.
Okay. Right. Now we've said that we need to do the due diligence. We certainly need to do the end bit and sort of check all the numbers, don't we? Is there anybody that could do a bit of it? You're not prepared to release that yet?
Not yet.
Right, okay, I'll let you leave that one on there. Right, do you need to travel about the place and check on the property?
No, I could get a handyman to do that, I suppose.
Right, okay, good. And searching for JV partners?
Yeah, I think that's got to be me.
Yeah, and I think that belongs maybe here.
Mm.
Yeah, what does everybody else think?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So, what would it mean to you if you could scrap all that knick-knack and trivia and spend all that time doing this or doing this,
mm-hmm.
or doing the end bit of the refurb and making sure you're happy with it?
Yeah, because spend all the time finding the deals, finding it.
So what difference would that make to your business?
Progress faster.
Very good. Thank you very much. That's a great example. So, that was a really good example. We've just demonstrated how Kellyanne can actually gain some time back to work on a business. So I'd like you all to think for a second, what is the biggest challenge or opportunity that your business faces at the minute? Does anybody mind sharing?
I haven't got enough time to fill the work I need to fill whilst I'm on a full-time job.
Right, okay. So that entire exercise, like the niff-naff and trivia stuff, could be the biggest challenge, couldn't it?
Yeah.
So actually working out a way to pass some of that work to somebody else could also be your biggest opportunity. So yeah, that's a great one. Anybody else?
It's kind of passing things that I've always felt had to be me to somebody else and trusting them to do it.
Yeah, that's your biggest challenge.
So delegating more and more, yeah.
And that was my biggest challenge. And when we first started doing this and outsourcing, we were laughing about this the other day. I gave tasks to them to do that I'd already done so I could check that it had been done right. but there is if you start off a little bit, it's amazing. You can really build up your confidence, especially.
especially if you've got you trust the person that you're delegating to and the system that you're using to do that. Anybody else?
It's getting more customers, more clients, more visitors, more tenants.
Yeah, so attracting leads, yeah. And we're going to talk about that a little bit more in a minute. So, in fact, we were going to have a guinea pig. Mo, can we borrow you, please? We're going to do a live demo of mapping how Mo attracts you guys into the room, if that's all right. Would you like to come in? I'm going to drive the computer, so I don't know if you want to just stand there for a second. Let's see if I can drive his computer, because I'm used to a Mac. Ooh. What do I do?
I'll stop it. It's been a while.
Right, so
good delegation.
Yeah.
Slavery,
right, so let me see. Sorry, bear with me, I'm complete. So what we use is my Simple Mind. It's mind mapping software. And it's free, there's a free version. I did get this all organised before I started, but it's completely and utterly vanished, isn't it? Can you see if you can open me a new one while I'm talking to you? So, the beauty of it is it's just got to be a brain dump. You don't have to have any special training, you don't have to be a business analyst, you don't have to know about decision diamonds and know how to actually map all this properly. It's literally, you need to get your ideas onto, you can do it on a piece of paper if you want, you can do it on post-it notes. But the reason that I like, Simple Mind is because you can change the order of things really easily. You can link it to other documents, you can do sub-processors, you can put audio in there, you can put pictures, you can put all sorts of stuff. Right, so Mo, tell us how you attract leads, how you get everybody into this room.
I use three platforms. I use Facebook, I use LinkedIn, and I use email.
Right, so tell us a little bit more about that. Do you do it on the fly, or do you do it?
I used to.
Now what do you do?
I put the charger in just before.
Sorry,
it's
alright, you'll
have to
excuse me. This isn't like the Mac version.
Right.
So, do you do it on the fly, or do you plan it in advance?
I used to, but now I've sort of got this system for myself.
Right, so what do you use? You're going to have to drive this one time.
Yeah.
I can't do both. Go on.
Yeah, firstly, I use Facebook Boost Post and Facebook Ads.
Okay.
And before, I used to just use text and content, but now I use more video.
Okay.
Try to use Facebook Live more near to the time of the event,
right,
a couple of days.
Okay.
And between that, I use posting within groups,
right,
maybe with a short video, or maybe with posts.
So do you do it as you go along, or do you plan it in advance?
No, I've sort of got a list.
Right.
So I sort of drip feed it through.
Okay.
For a couple of weeks.
Right, okay. So we start off with a list, and then you post it on certain days.
Yeah, I try and do two or three.
Right.
Yeah.
Okay. And you've got a mixture of paid and organic posts. So if anybody doesn't know what organic means, that basically means anything that you don't pay for. So what Nigel was talking about was boosting your posts and paying for your advertising. Okay. Right. And you were saying you use LinkedIn as well?
Yes, I do.
Yeah, and email. Right. So what happens? What happens to the people that see your posts? What happens to them next?
Just the post.
Yeah. So if I see one of your posts on Facebook, what happens?
Well, I mean the content that's coming out.
Yeah. What do I do?
Yeah, so
how do I end up here after I've seen the Facebook
post?
Okay.
So I give a brief, sort of overview of what's going to happen.
Yeah.
Maybe like the speakers or some other part of the event.
Yeah.
Leave links in the post,
okay,
and also my email address as well if they need to contact me regarding something.
Okay, so what are the links in the post?
The link to my website.
The link to your website?
Yeah.
Okay, cool. Right, and what's on your website?
Information, you can buy a ticket on my website.
Okay, right. And how do they buy the ticket?
There's
that.
A, there's a.
Yeah, sorry, go on.
Yeah, there's a form on there. There's a web form that can go and put your details in there.
And
yeah.
Does that link, is that your payment platform or is that Progressive's?
Yes, Infusionsoft.
So it's Progressive's?
Yeah, yeah.
Okay.
So
well,
I get a notification.
Okay. So we've kind of got a bit of a plan of what we're going to do, and then we do it, and then they may or may not go to your website, they may or may not email you, and then when they do fill in the form, the details go to Progressive and not to you.
Yeah, it's a franchise.
Yeah.
But
so
I do have a backend system where I can access it.
Right, okay. So what happens then? So these people turn up, we've all turned up, and then what happens? So you've made it easy for us to buy.
Yeah.
Some of us have probably bought online, so that's good. So it's easy for us to transact.
Yeah.
And we turned up. And then is that it? Do we wander off into the night, never to be heard of again?
I wonder again. Hopefully everyone likes it.
And
I do. You mean follow up after the
event?
Yeah.
Well, we've all gone home. Do we ever hear from you ever again? Or?
Yes, you do. Yeah.
Yeah.
People who have attended and do. Yeah.
So
well, I'm sure you do. By anyone.
So, is that just the people that have attended, or is that everybody that's shown an interest in your social media posts?
No, just people.
So, can you keep in touch with all the people that have shown an interest in your social media posts?
No, only the people that are on your email list.
Right.
Not
and how do people
media.
Get on your email list?
Well, with social media, send out a post after the event, tagging people in,
right.
So that way they do know. Tell them to like and share it, so that way I can get across it organically.
So you're relying on your social media for communicating?
Not all of them, no.
So, right, so what we're trying to do at the minute, we're trying to document the process as is. So we're not trying to improve it, we're trying to find out exactly what happens now, which is why I'm asking them. Loads and loads of questions, okay? So let's just see if we've got this right so far, and you can tell me if we've got it wrong. So we've got social media, Facebook, I think it was LinkedIn, you don't use Twitter, do you? But we'll let him off.
Somebody
have
my Twitter account, I haven't used it again.
And we can use paid or just organic. They're clicking on links, they go to your website, they may email you for more information, and then you personally have got their email address. So they purchase the through the web form, which is Progressive, and then when they attend, they sign a sheet, you get their email address. Then what happens?
For me to put everything through the back-end system, so obviously how they pay for their ticket, whether they buy cash, card,
yeah.
Or payment, so that all goes in.
So then, how do you communicate with the people that have all attended tonight?
I can take off the CSV sheet,
right
off the backend system,
okay, and then
or I can put it in manually. If that can
okay. And where do you put it?
Into my mail chain.
Okay, right. Okay, so then we start the cycle again.
Yes.
Communicating and generating interest for the next month. Yeah. So is that an accurate representation of what happens currently at the minute?
Yes, at the moment.
Yeah? Okay. Are you happy to stay there for a couple more
yeah,
minutes? Yeah. can you just flip back to the slides a sec, please, Steve? So what we need to think about is how can we make this better? So there's no point sort of automating something that's that's not particularly efficient. So if we build automation into a process that's not particularly efficient, we're just going to magnify it. So the real challenge is to think, right, how can we make this better? So are we happy to have a go and see if we've got any ideas how we can make it better for more? Has anybody got any suggestions?
The map.
Any suggestions? Issues tonight. Talking to the projector. right, let's brainstorm. How could we make it better from them? Go on.
I think Mo could send out the emails immediately after the meeting saying thanks for coming, it was a great night. The next, look at our picture, everyone, look at, you know, what we did.
Yeah.
The next meeting is, and get that in 4 weeks in advance, so it's got 4 weeks of marketing rather than 2.5.
You mean within the email that I've sent out after the event, tell you about the next?
Yeah, the date, so.
Yeah, I do, but I think it might be because it's near the bottom, or not in the case, I don't know.
Because she's too much other stuff to do.
So,
yeah.
So what we talk about,
yeah,
is
no,
attract,
but I
so we talk about attract, sell and wow. So there's three distinct phases. So in the attract phase, the biggest thing that sticks out to us is that you're not building your own list, and Nigel was saying that sort of building your list is the most important thing.
Yeah.
So the only time we fill in our details is actually to pay for a ticket, and that goes straight into Progressive system. But if there was a way of attracting leads, maybe with lead magnets, so you could maybe do a report or something that people might be interested in about property generally, and actually then you're getting their email addresses, because the only people that you can market to at the minute are the people that have already turned up, and you're possibly missing like a huge amount of people and leads that are actually interested in property. So can we stick something in there about lead magnets and building a list? Would that be something that you feel like you could do?
Something I would do, but I just don't know.
Okay. So they can still go through Progressive for the sell bit, because that makes it really, really easy, and it probably has to do because it's a franchise. But then when we come to the wow phase, which is how we follow people up, like Kellyanne said, sending the follow-up email, thanks for coming, you could ask for some feedback, you could ask for some feedback on the speakers. And then you could say something like, do you know anybody else that would be interested? Can you refer a friend? And perhaps incentivize people to do that. So that you're asking referrals so that it kind of organically grows like that. And the only other thing that I was thinking is you could use something like Hootsuite or Buffer to actually schedule your posts in advance. So have a real plan for maybe if you don't want to do a month in advance, sit down and just do a week in advance. So that those posts are going out rather than you doing it on the fly. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
Okay. So you can see how we can sort of build, we need to look at how it is now and then think how can we make it better before we start to build in any more
routine.
Pardon?
Can I have that?
Yeah. And then once you've started to build your list, this is where you build your automation then into your follow-up emails. So you can have a trigger. Like a countdown to the next event. You can send text messages out as reminders to people who, you know, that's
to be honest with that, I've tried text messages.
You've tried text messages?
Painless.
Okay.
I get it from Progressive.
Yeah, they do a separate one, but I tried to do one of my own.
Yeah.
And transferring that CSV into there, I found it a bit of a trouble. I don't know if I'm using the right platform or not. If you could recommend a good platform.
Can I have a chat after all?
A countdown to the next event kind of thing. And just keep a bit, and just in between times maybe just sending a bit of content out, so it's not, so they always say sort of three pieces of content and then one sale. So sort of looking around, using things like Google Alerts to find content about property that other people might be interested in, and just bobbing it in an email and sending it out. So everybody see how we started off with what how it was and then moved to what it could be, and how Simple Minds is a really good way of just dumping everything onto the paper. Thank you very much, Mo. That wasn't simple. Right. So once we've made the process better, this is where we've got to start to document everything so that we can actually start to outsource it. And this is the way to become sort of consistent and get consistent results is to get really good at documenting our tasks. So we've got, I need some more audience participation. Could I have a couple more volunteers, please? I'm doing it for time. Can I have a couple more volunteers, please? Come on then. Right. Do you document tasks in your business? Right. Would you mind wearing a blindfold?
Valentine's.
Can I have somebody else up to the front, please?
Leo.
process.
Come on! Come on, come on, Haroon. Right, you just take a step back then, because you're all right. That's it now, Haroon. Yeah, I'm going to leave you. Right, come and take a seat. Right, now this isn't my supper here. This is for the task. So we've got some bread, we've got a knife, we've got some butter, and we've got some jam. So, Chris, I'd like you to tell Haroon how to make a jam sandwich, please.
All right, okay. Step one, sit down at the table.
Oh, I've done this before. Yeah.
Step two, find a knife.
Oh, he has done this before, he's good.
Step three, find the margarine on the spread. Open the spread. Step five, spread it with the knife, spread it onto the bread. step six, is the jam there?
Yeah.
Yeah. So step six, open the jam, spread the jam. step seven, put a little bit of bread on top of the first bit of bread. Voila.
Well,
good sandwich.
Fantastic. Let's take the blindfold off and see what he's created for your tea.
So at this point you call him a blithering idiot.
Oh, come on.
In 2014, Stu gave up his consulting role because he wanted to spend more time at home with us. I was expecting him to go. And I gave up my work as a self-employed physio because I wanted to work more sociable hours that fitted in more around my family. Right, okay. And we dreamed of our online heating business. Fast forward to the 8th of July 2015. So I was holding my second baby girl in my arms, gazing at a little miracle there. All wrapped up in blankets in a standard issue woolly hat with a crumpled up little face. Just started our new heating business and we were excited and hopeful that, you know, life was good. But it wasn't long before things started to change. So we were working late every night, blogs, social media, customer inquiries. I was answering the phone, processing sales on the kitchen table, the phone in one hand, computer in the other, baby on the knee. Constant rounds because we were tired and stressed and all the hard work didn't appear to be reaping rewards. And we knew that something had to change, but we were so stuck in our business with the daily firefights that we just couldn't get the clarity to move forward. And one morning a week, I used to go to the baby sensory classes with my little girl, and during the final song, he had to cuddle your baby really tight and he used to gaze into her eyes and there'd just be tears rolling down my face because it was just the 1 hour a week that I had on my own. And even then I couldn't concentrate because my phone was quivering in my back pocket. And I thought, right, enough is enough, something's got to change. we had to start running this business, you know, rather than it running us. So bit by bit, we documented, reviewed, improved, implemented, automated, outsourced, and we used the knowledge that Stu had implemented in other businesses, in other people's businesses, and the experience that I had of running my own business, and we applied them to our own. And now, by following this sort of simple system and introducing automation, life is very different. And our heating business pretty much takes care of itself, which gives me a chance to focus on other things that I'm passionate about, like property, just like yourselves. So if we can do it, so can you. So we've been making jam sandwiches tonight, but what I want you to go away and do is think about hot beef. So I knew I'd get an acronym in there, so I can't take the credit for this one. So what we've talked about is in the plan stage, we looked at how we think it works, but then we've got to actually observe how it actually works, and often there's a discrepancy between the two. You might think you know what you're doing in business, but actually then you might go and speak to somebody in the office and they might say, no, that's not how it happens. So make sure that those two are actually the same. Then we're going to improve it, document it, and test it. So you test it by giving it to somebody that's never done it before to see if they can follow your instructions. So now we're going to come into our build phase of our five-step system. This is where the beef comes in. So we're going to build it, evaluate it, evolve it, and then we're going to fix the date to review it. So we're going to do another bit of participation just to wrap up tonight. So are we ready to build in some automation here? Are we ready to see what automation can do for us?
Yeah.
Right, who does HMOs in the room? I need three people. Can I have three volunteers this time, please?
Go
on then.
Go on then.
Kellyanne, you're going to come to the front. It's determined to get you some time wrestled back. Right, okay. So we'll start off at that end with Kellyanne. Would you mind sharing with the room how you'll go about finding tenants, please?
I have a spare room and then also post them on various Facebook groups throughout the local area, links to the spare room and book. And then people ring me up,
right, good.
And then I go do the viewings and show them around, and then I do all the documents and sign them in and check them in.
Okay. What happens if they're not ready yet, or if they don't particularly like that area, or they're just not, you know, maybe it's just not the right time for them? Do you just forget about them?
Just forget about them.
Yeah, keep looking. Interesting. Right. Okay. Chris, would you mind sharing how you check your tenants in?
I don't.
Good. Leveraged. Right.
Yeah.
Would you mind sharing how the people in your business do that?
How
yeah.
you think it's done?
Yeah, exactly. I'm just thinking jam sandwiches now. how do they do it? Good question. So the lead will come in, they pass the reference in, they paid their money, it's all done.
How
so
do you do your referencing?
Amy does it. I've not spoken to a tenant for 3 years.
Good, well, it's outsourced, that's great.
So in essence, the move-in pack is created,
mm-hmm.
the tenancy agreements are all signed, everything. The appointment is created, and the letting negotiator moves them in. Points into the property, shows them around where things are, what works, and what, you know, that kind of stuff.
Okay.
That's it.
Super. Right, thank you very much. And Nigel, would you mind sharing with everybody how you communicate with your tenants thereafter?
You can read into this why I'm here and not at home on Valentine's Day with my wife, but I get my wife to do it.
Well, that's outsourced. That's fine. Well, would you mind sharing
what she
does?
She. For just normal things,
anything?
She would group text them.
Right, okay, good. And what kind of things does she communicate with them?
Why does the sink and all the tiles come away from the wall? Or something like that.
Right.
She actually.
Is that just in response
no,
to a particular...
I'm not thinking that's wrong.
is that just in response to a particular situation, or do you have a routine communication?
We do a monthly audit
So we go around and use the eye auditor.
Right,
okay. Go around and just do a quick scan of the building and then send that report to them.
Okay.
And there might be the odd comments on there.
Right. Okay. Right, so we'll go back to the beginning. So can we think how we might, thinking about what we've learnt tonight, how we might improve Kellyanne's process, how she goes about finding her tenants? Any suggestions?
Call answering service.
Call answering service, yeah.
So your adverts, you post your adverts so you know what you're saying, you know it's all compliant. Then you have a call answering service that asks a load of questions to each applicant so you know if they're going to qualify.
Yeah. What's possibly the most important question they could ask when they answer that call?
When do you want to move?
A date that they would ask? The prospective tenant might ask? A call answering person. The Vera on the end of the phone. What might she ask?
Contact
details. Yeah. Email address. Because if that person isn't ready yet, it might be... Because if this is what we want them to do, and this is where they are now, it might be a series of stepping stones before we get there. So if we drop them here, we might be able to just gently keep walking them through by just little gentle keeping in touch emails about random things like how best to maximise space in a house share or something like that, or you know, just information pieces, just tickling them along that journey. So call answering service. What else? How else might we be able to make booking the viewing and stuff a lot easier for her?
Go with a calendar manager or some online platform.
Yeah.
Where they can either book it, you know, she can say these are the times when the bookings are.
Exactly.
So you block them out and
exactly.
Then they opt into which one they want.
Exactly. So if you had a couple of options, because otherwise you might have Bob that wants to come on so and so, Fred that wants to come, Mary and blah blah, and you could be going backwards and forwards, which even if it's only 5 miles, could be 10 miles 5 times in your car. That's a lot of miles.
If you have two people turning up to look at the same room at the same time, it creates motivation.
It does. Scarcity and rarity. Absolutely, yeah, definitely. Okay, so have you ever had a situation where they didn't turn up to a booking?
Twice.
To a viewing, twice. Okay. So you can send them text reminders. You could send them a reminder like 3 hours in advance. Can't wait to meet you tonight to show you around blah blah street, something like that. So quite quickly you could save time, potentially earn more money, and you start to build a consistency in your approach that gets noticed by people because it comes across as much more professional than anybody else. Right, checking in that you don't know about because you're so amazingly leveraged you don't need to worry about it. So any ideas how we could automate that from what we've learned tonight? Anything?
Certainly send some of the documents
yep.
to them prior to them checking.
We use DocuSign now, not WordPress.
Yeah, DocuSign. So anybody who doesn't know what DocuSign is, you can sign digitally.
You've still got to demonstrate certain items.
Yeah. So
there and then.
Right.
Well, that
goes
in your moving pack in the that's
yeah.
the deregulation stuff.
So checking in. Yeah.
So what these are sequences. So you could trigger a sequence. Yep, somebody's a trigger a sequence to ask for all these particular documents, and it could sort of say whether or not you've received them and chased them if they haven't. Then once they've passed all the referencing and you've got all those documents back, you could trigger another sequence. So once you've checked them in and you've shown them around, so if there's any sort of processes that you need to go through, you could have check boxes on the system to do them. And in the welcome pack, that could be emailed to them. Then you could send them little emails saying things like, the bins get put out on Thursday, an email about what to do if you get locked out in the middle of the night and you can't find your keys, so that you're heading problems off at the pass, that kind of thing. And all part of you, and one of those emails could be just a little bit more information about the surrounding area, where the nearest takeaway or hospital is, whatever's most important to them. So it makes them feel welcome and it makes them sort of feel special. Any other ideas on that one?
Put everything on an online platform so that they can log in as a tenant login
yeah.
with a sequence of problems.
Yeah.
So like, you know, I've got this problem, I've lost my keys, and it just tells them what to do.
Yeah.
So they don't have to ring you until
yeah.
the very last point.
Yeah, could do. And
if it got to the point where you did ring them and Vera answered the phone, because you're not answering the phone anymore, she could just trigger something that sends an automatic email telling you what to do, something like that. Okay, thank you. Right, routine communication. What kind of things? Any ideas? So think about our attract, sell and wow model. So we've attracted them, we've sold to them, and now we're going to wow them.
What?
Any ideas?
Wouldn't it be easy to do it on email and then you can like mail shite to? Would it not be easier to systemize it on an email as opposed to text messages?
Yeah.
I think that's what I mean.
Yeah, you could do either. You could send an email out after they've been in for a few weeks asking for some feedback. And then depending on the feedback, so if you've got really good feedback, you could say, oh, brilliant. Have you got any friends that are looking for rooms? And again, incentivize them asking for a referral. Or if you got some rubbish feedback, you could take action on it because you'd rather know. But you'd rather
they're
know.
They're obviously not telling you, Billy.
Yeah. So asking for feedback. You could send something out about a little article about remember to open the windows when you have a shower and open the windows when you're cooking so that you can avoid damp, stuff like that. Informative things that you send in them so that you're heading problems off at the pass. But yeah, asking for referrals is a great one and feedback so that they're starting to attract leads for you.
Mm-hmm.
Any other ideas? Any other suggestions?
What about old school lumpy mail? Did you put something special in the post for them?
Well, it's too soft.
If they're good.
Yeah, possibly. Okay, has that given us all some ideas that we could implement?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Got the old cogs wearing? Thank you very much. Very good. So, we're nearly there. So, what if? So you might be saying, what if? Just don't have the time to do all this planning and thinking. I don't know where to start. What I would say is just do a little bit every day. And that's how I started. Literally every task I did, I wrote it down or I dictated it and got my VA to type it up and put it on the Google Drive. So you might be thinking, well, it's already pretty good. I've got Vera in the office. She makes me a cup of tea. She looks after me. She knows what she's doing. I don't think I can make it any better. But what if Vera was taken ill? What if your business grows so rapidly that Vera can't keep up? So automation software can do everything that Vera does. So it can organise and segment your customer information. It can chase up your paperwork, like forms and contracts. It can ask for feedback and referrals. And most importantly, it can stay on top of quotes and billings. So your things like your handymen and your contractors and stuff, it can keep on top of all of that as well. So instead of looking like this poor chap, you can look like this chap here. So when are you going to do it? So this is my dream. I want to be able to go to Colorado for the summer and be a cowgirl. That's what I want to do, yeah. So if your business can run without you, there's no reason why you can't follow your dreams. So if you need any help or you want to know more, you can book a call with us, get in touch. And let's see if I can help you make 2017 more best year yet. Thank you very much, everyone.